هذا البرنامج برعاية FTNFT.
رغم مواجهة عالم الميتافيرس أزمة بسوق العقارات، الرئيس التنفيذي لأبيك متفائل بشأن العالم الافتراضي، وباينانس تطلق خدمة بيلد ذا بلوك. أما مبيعات سويتش تضغط على نتائج نينتندو الفصلية. أهلا وسهلا بكم في حلقة جديدة من Game Changers. معي أنا حنان الكبات وبول دوليبي. Paul, how are you today?
I'm doing great.
I'm super excited. We have a lot of interesting news today.
Yeah, like a metaverse-themed episode, which is fun. I always like when our stories all come together into one nice, beautiful theme.
Let's get started. يعاني عالم الميتافيرس بتقنية البلوك تشين من أزمة في قطاع العقارات، خاصة مع انخفاض أسعار الأراضي بسبب تلاشي اهتمام المستخدمين، متسببة بخسائر للمستثمرين تفوق 90% خلال 14 شهراً الماضية.
So Paul, according to this news, it shows that the world of metaverse with blockchain technology is suffering from crisis in the real estate. Tell me more about it.
Yeah, let's be clear. This is very specific to blockchain and crypto real estate or metaverse real estate. So virtual land that was being sold to people, frankly, who were speculating that the value of this virtual land was going to go up. Now, look, there's a reason why the values of this land or the value of this land is down 90% from their highs. It's no surprise to me. And the reason is there's a couple of reasons. One, there's artificial scarcity around virtual land. It's not like you buy a plot of land here in Dubai where there's only so much land available. In a digital world where land can be created at the press of a button, you have basically no scarcity. And because you have no scarcity, the value is dependent on what someone will pay for it, not on some inherent value. So I think it's no surprise that the values have dropped. I think the other big problem that virtual land has from a value standpoint is distance doesn't matter in the metaverse. You can travel instantly from one place to another. So there's no extra value being downtown or being close to
exactly.
something of value.
There's no rules at
the exactly,
end.
Exactly.
We also have another interesting news from Binance. Let's check it out.
أطلقت باينانس خدمة بيلد ذا بلوك، وهي سلسلة رقمية عالمية جديدة تتنافس فيها شركات ويب 3 الناشئة من أجل الحصول على تمويل من قبل باينانس لابس. So what's Build the Block from Binance? Explain to me what's going on.
Well, they're launching a competition show, Binance is, which I think is interesting, right? They're trying to find some of the more interesting metaverse-themed projects out there, and they're using a Shark Tank style.
Trying to be out of the box.
Trying to be out of the box. And I think, again, more content in this space is never a bad thing. I think everyone who works in metaverse or Web3 or gaming has a desire to consume more content, and there's just not a lot of it out there, other than Game Changers, of course. But I think this is interesting for a couple of reasons. One, when you look at the names of the 12 groups that they've selected for this first season of the show, almost none of them, I think only two of the 12 were even gaming related or touched gaming in any way. And I think they're gonna find this is a mistake. The future of the metaverse, I've always said, is in gaming, and all of these other things are sort of extraneous. They're on the outside. They're not the core of what will make the metaverse successful. So right from the get-go, I think they're going to struggle because they haven't picked a great selection of 12 companies to at least evaluate or compete against each other.
Paul, let's talk about Epic as well.
الرئيس التنفيذي لشركة إيبك يرد بتغريدة على مقولة أن العالم الافتراضي عبر الإنترنت قد ولى ذاكراً أنه يوجد أكثر من 600 مليون مستخدم نشط شهرياً، وهو ما زال متفائلاً بشأن المستقبل في الميتافيرس.
So the CEO of Epic tweeted a tweet, and it's quite interesting because it's about the metaverse. Explain to me.
Yeah, look, I often disagree with Tim Sweeney, who's the CEO of Epic Games. I've disagreed publicly that, you know, his fight with Apple is probably a waste of resources or a lack of focus on his part. But here I agree with him 100%. And what he's addressing in this tweet is all of the commentary around metaverse recently. When I say recently, I mean in the last few months, is the metaverse is dead. Everyone's talking about AI. No one's talking about metaverse anymore. And first of all, that's just untrue. And second of all, what he gets at with his comment on Twitter is he's saying, look, You're right. The metaverse is dead. Let's invite the 600 million people who play Fortnite, Roblox, Minecraft, all of these metaverses, and we'll have a funeral for the metaverse. Obviously, he's being sarcastic, but what he's saying is the metaverse today is extremely popular. There's 600 million people who occupy metaverses on a daily basis. We just have to reframe how we think about metaverse and how we define metaverse, because it really is gaming at its core.
So you still think metaverse is the future?
Of course, because gaming is the future.
Also, let's check out another interesting news story, and this time about Nintendo. أبلغت نينتندو عن انخفاض في الأرباح والإيرادات بالسنة المالية بسبب انخفاض مبيعات جهاز الألعاب سويتش، حيث باعت الشركة حوالي 18 مليون وحدة، وتوقعت نينتندو مبيعات تقدر ب 15 مليون وحدة للسنة المالية المنتهية في مارس 2024. So Nintendo reported a decrease in profits and revenues. What this has to be with the something with Switch? Like Switch is related because of the decrease in the sales of Switch. Tell me more about it.
Look, if I was at PIF right now, I would probably be a little upset because they just spent $500 million buying an extra 1% of Nintendo. But I don't think this was a surprise, because frankly, the Switch is an old console. Consoles have a very sort of defined cycle of how many years they're popular before the technology goes out of date. And the Switch is an old console by any standard. It's 6-7 years old now. It's time for Nintendo to come out with new hardware. Now, I think there's a hidden variable, though, in these less than stellar results for Nintendo. And the hidden variable is, I think the next quarter is actually going to be much stronger compared to the quarter a year ago. And it's because of one game in particular, which is the new Zelda game. So Zelda is a big driver of both console sales, Switch sales, and is a big driver of revenue for Nintendo directly, because it's a huge IP. Everyone who owns a Switch probably will play Zelda. And so I think while the hardware numbers are down and will continue to be down over the next few quarters, I actually think for Nintendo the next quarter will actually be quite interesting because of Zelda.
Let's continue our chat with our guest for today. وللحديث أكثر حول عالم ألعاب الفيديو ينضم إلينا أوسكار ويندل، وهو مدير أول في Future Blockchain Summit. Hello Oscar and welcome to Game Changers. We're so happy to have you here in the studio.
Thank you, Hannah.
So first of all, let me ask you, how have you seen the buzz around gaming and esports grow in Dubai over the last few years?
Especially in the last year, I think it's been growing explosively with the Dubai Esports Festival that took place at Expo last year, and now with the crypto community coming in with Web3 and gaming, mobile, different platforms, it's growing in a very big way and getting a very broad appeal.
Oscar, how can a country really benefit from hosting large-scale gaming and esports events? Like, where is the benefit to the country that hosts these large events?
I think that gaming really appeals to all kinds of new audiences, and everyone is curious with the new types of games that are coming on with mobile and not just the esports. As such, it's so interactive with events as well. It's not just a spectator sport. You can play at these events themselves, and I think it's a great way to come together across cultures. It's a universal language.
So in your opinion, Oscar, how will gaming feature at GITEX this year?
Well, I look after a part called the Future Blockchain Summit, where we're really concentrating on the Web3 community and crypto and metaverse. So there we're going to have a stage. We're going to call it the Gaming Coliseum, and bring in the esports and entertainment with fashion from the US, having a fashion show with music and creators and parties. So it's gonna be a lot of fun this year.
So in your opinion, why the region is so interested in video game industry?
I think the stars have aligned for the region with its young audience that is very energetic and competitive, and that it's what they're really good at.
You think it's the future?
Oh, no doubt. That's undeniable. It's just how much of the future will be taken up by gaming.
But do you think having gaming as part of a forum like Future Blockchain Summit or GITEX, do you think this solves one of the problems of at least making gaming relatable to the mainstream? Like, does it help address some of the preconceived notions around gaming, maybe some of the negative ones?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think with esports events, it tends to appeal to a certain subset of mostly men, I suppose. But gaming is really big, and I mean, especially in Japan, for instance, it has a huge audience of women that are older, and now this is going to expose a lot of new audiences to new types of games, not just the first shooter.
Thank you so much, Oscar, for your input.
Thank you.
وبهذا كان معنا أوسكار وندل وهو مدير أول في Future Blockchain Summit. لدينا سؤال على تويتر يقول: هل باتت ألعاب الفيديو تستحوذ على نسبة من إنفاق الأسر؟ So we have this poll from Twitter. It says, do video games take a portion from household spendings? We could have a debate on this question, by the way.
Now look, if you're spending anything on video games, it's by definition taking a portion from your household spending. I think what's interesting here, though, is the mix. And let's separate the first answer from the last two. The people who buy games right when a game launches,
they're 32.7%.
I think that's reflective of the portion of the industry that is still doing like boxed copy games. In other words, a $60 or $70 game that you buy, you pay for it once, and then you can play it as much as you want. The rest is a little bit sneakier spending, because what a lot of the gaming industry has moved to is free to play, where you don't pay anything up front for the game. So the gamer says, well, look, I'm not spending any of my household spending on games, but then maybe you buy that skin, or that cosmetic, or that gun skin, or that, you know, car skin if it's Rocket League or whatever, or that player if it's FIFA or whatever you may be spending in game, and you don't realize $5 here, $10
exactly.
here, $2 here.
You end up spending a lot.
You end up spending more than the $60 or $70 exactly. at launch, but it's spread over maybe 12 or 18 months.
I really enjoyed this episode, Paul. We covered much more like news about Nintendo, Epic, so it was like very nice.
I liked it too. It's always fun to talk about metaverse and gaming and how those two things interrelate.
Do you have any last comment you'd like to say?
As always, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you. مشاهدينا وصلنا لنهاية حلقتنا لهذا الأسبوع. انتظرونا الأسبوع المقبل بأخبار جديدة ومواضيع متنوعة تتمحور جميعها حول عالم ألعاب الفيديو. إلى اللقاء.
هذا البرنامج برعاية FTNFT.